Yeah, let's now generalize the concept of logistic regression to multiple classes. This is also known as softmax regression, or sometimes also called multinomial logistic regression. So for this, we will consider a relatively simple dataset, the MNIST dataset. I already introduced this in the introductory lectures. So these are 60,000 handwritten digits in the training set. And yeah, it's a nice and balanced data set. So balanced means that there's the same number of training examples per class. So in this case, we have 10 classes, the handwritten digits 0 to 9, and there are 6,000 digits per class. Here's an example of how these digits look like. And each of these training examples here has an image dimension of 28 times 28 times 1. So 28 for the height and 28 for the width. So this is the number of pixels. So we have in total 784 pixels or features per training example. In PyTorch, we will be using a format so-called NCHW, which is how we represent a mini batch or an image batch. So here, in this case, we have 128 examples in that mini batch. So the 128 is for this N here. Then we have the color channel. We have only one color channel because these are black and white images, so there are no red, green, and blue colors. And then we have the height, so 28 pixels. And for the width, we have also 28 pixels. This is usually how we read in a data set into PyTorch, and we will be also looking at code examples for that. So just to recap, we have 60,000 training examples and then the corresponding labels. And then we have for the test images and test labels, 10,000 each. So that's just how the dataset looks like. For softmax regression, we will actually be concatenating these images or these features in the image to a long vector, like we discussed in the introductory lecture. So here's just an example of how kind of diverse these handwritings are. So these are all the letter the number 7, so illustrations of different sevens. So different people writing down a 7, and you can see it varies a lot. So personally, where I grew up in Germany, we usually write a 7 like this with this cross line here. In the US, it's more common to write it like this, but you can see there are also very interesting flavors of this. For example, it looks like a C almost. Here, this one is actually interesting because in Germany, we write a 1 as follows, like this. This is a 1 in Germany. In the US, 1 is usually written as this one. So, but you can see, just by looking at these handwritings, it's sometimes maybe not even clear what the number is. So if I wouldn't tell you that these are different illustrations of 7s, some people might think these might be 1s, and this actually, I don't even know. It could be a C if you have a data set of letters and digits, for example. So, like I mentioned, in the context of PyTorch and when we work with unstructured data, also later with convolutional networks, we would be working with the format, the NCHW, as follows. So this would be a four-dimensional tensor. I think I introduced that in the first lecture of this course, so a long time ago. So here's how it would look like in PyTorch, where we have this four-dimensional tensor. Actually, in this case, it's a three-dimensional tensor. I only represent one single image. So it's a single image here at the bottom, representing the number 3. And you can see there are different values from 0 to 0.5. I think the highest one would be approaching 1. And that is because I normalized these pixels by dividing them by 255. And this is because, these values between or around 0, or in this case between 0 and 1, work better with gradient descent. It would be even better, for example, to normalize these images such that they are centered at 0. So you can, for example, subtract a 0.5. If you have the range between 0 and 1, you can subtract a 0.5, and then it will be ranging between minus 0.5 to 0.5, and this would work even better, or people say that would work better with gradient descent because now it's centered at zero and you can have positive and negative inputs equally. However, in practice, personally, for these simple data sets, I don't notice a big difference, especially if we work with logistic regression. Sometimes I put more effort into normalizing the input images, for example, doing the standard standardization, what people call the standard normal data. So it's giving your data the properties of a standard normal distribution, but of course, if your data is not normally distributed from begin with, it will also not be normally distributed after normalizing. So what I mean is, for example, if you have, let's call that X prime, if you have a given feature, X, you subtract the mean of the feature and then divide it by the standard deviation. So this would be called standardization. Or some people just call that z-score normalization. This is also recommended. We can do that here too, but since the images or the features, the features are all equal, they are all from 0 to 255. For pixels, it wouldn't make a big difference whether we use this standardization or just scale them between the range minus 0.5 and 0.5. So that's like a minor detail. All right, so I'm getting sidetracked here. What I wanted to mention is the main point here is what we are doing now is we are concatenating. So if I go back, we are concatenating the rows. So if you consider, fortunately there's a line wrapping here, if you consider this here as the first row, then I can maybe write this down. First row, first row, and then second row, third row, and so forth. If we concatenate these rows, we get a one long vector here. That's how it looks like. So here I've concatenated these rows. Just to illustrate this again, let me jump back one more time. So here in green, this would be really the first row in this image here. In blue, this would be second row. And the third row here in red would be this one. If we concatenate them, by that I mean if we make one long vector, so the green one first, then the blue one, and then the red one, we can use that as input for our logistic regression model. And in the case of the MNIST dataset, we have more than two classes, so we are going to use softmax regression. Yeah, to just briefly recap before I introduce the softmax model, here is a drawing of the regular logistic regression model for the binary classification case. So as input, we have a feature vector, and then we have this weight vector, so we compute the dot product between the two, add the bias unit, which gives us the net input, and then we put the net input through a nonlinear activation function, the logistic sigmoid function, which we defined as follows. And then what it represents is the probability. So this represents the probability that a training example belongs to class 1. If we wanted to compute the probability that it belongs to class 0, we could compute it as 1 minus this, right? 1 minus this probability. This would give us the probability that it belongs to class 0. But back to this one here now. So we have a probability and it belongs to class 1. And then we can say if this probability is greater, if p is greater than 0.5, then class 1. And if it's smaller than 0.5, class 0. So how can we generalize this now to multiple classes? So for that, we can actually extend this model. So here's a drawing of a model that would work with a multi-class classification data set where we have more than two classes. So just to jump back one more time. So this model here that I'm circling in green, this can actually be thought of as a model that is embedded in this bigger model here. So if we have the same inputs here, it's the same as before, our feature vector of dimensionality m, we can think of everything I'm drawing now in green as the same model that I showed you before, right? So if you look at this, it's the same model. I mean, it's of course a little bit skewed because these lines are a little bit different, but it's essentially the same model. And so this would be one logistic regression model. And for that one, we have a feature vector of dimensionality m. So we can have the feature vector, let's write it down like 1, 1, oops, let's do it like this, 1, 1, 1, 2, and 1, let's say 3 if we have 3 classes. If we have 3 features, let's do m to have it more general. So if we have m features, we have this feature vector here. And notice now, I mean, we have multiple of these logistic regression models. The second model would be this one here, right? It's another logistic regression model, same inputs. And for this one, we can also have a feature vector. For this one, we could have the feature vector 2, 1, 2, 2, and 2m. And then there's a third model here, right? So it's a third model. And for that, we also have a feature vector. We can write it as W3, 1, W2, 3, 2, and W3, 3. Right, so if I call this feature vector, let's call it W1, and this is W2, and this is W3, right? So I have now 3 feature vectors. So if I stack them, I can stack them to make a feature matrix. So this matrix here, so I can write this matrix as, I would need to transpose this. So we would have W1 transpose, W2 transpose, and W3 transpose. So this would be my feature matrix of dimensionality H times M, where H is the number of output nodes here. So this would be one way I could generalize my logistic regression model. And then we can compute also the class membership probabilities here. However, notice now the class membership probabilities work a little bit differently. So because we don't have a binary classification problem now, but each node is still binary. So here, let's say in green, this would be the probability that this is class 1. In blue, this is the probability that is class 2. But now each probability works like this, that it is the probability that this is the class, so the probability that it is class 3 versus not being class 3. So what can happen is that, or what will probably likely happen is that these probabilities don't sum up to 1. So for example, for a given input, if we have the digit 3, we may get a probability that this is 0.3, or let's say 33%, that this is in class 1. Let's say 40% that this is class 2, and then 70% that this is class 3. So, but these don't sum up to 1. So, for example, if the probability is 40% that this is class 2, the probability that this is not class 2 would be 60%. And for this one, for the first one, the probability that it would be class 3 would be 67%. In any case, these probabilities don't sum up to 1. If we also take a look at this one, these don't sum up to 1. It can be a little bit weird. So if we have a number, let's say the digit 3, how can it be 33% number 1, 40% number 2, and 70% probability number 3? It doesn't really make intuitive sense. I think this would make sense if we have a data set when the classes are not mutually exclusive. For example, if you have something like a vehicle, there's a high probability that an object in an image is a vehicle, there's maybe also probability greater than 50% that this is a car, and then maybe a certain probability that it's a certain brand of a car, and so forth. So where we don't have mutually exclusive classes. But in the case of digits, it would be more intuitive if these probabilities sum up to one. And for that, we have this multinomial logistic regression model, or softmax regression model. So what I showed you in the previous case was more like a concatenation of individual logistic regression models. Here would be the real multinomial logistic regression model, where we assume that the classes are mutually exclusive. So what is the difference between this slide and the previous slide? So if I go back one more time, in the previous slide, it's hard to see now, but we had one sigmoid activation in each node here. So I'm getting rid now of this sigmoid activation and have a so-called softmax activation. And also notice that I'm drawing it a little bit differently. Before, I was drawing it inside here because they were all independent from each other. Now, the softmax activation is actually not independent for each node. So all the activation go into the same softmax activation. And then there's some computation going on. I will explain to you how that works in the next video. And what comes out are these activations that now sum up to one. So these sum up to one. So for example, the first one may be 10% probability that it belongs to class one. Then that might be 20% for class two and 70% for class three and so forth. And how can we then convert it into a class label? We would take the argmax. So the argmax is the position, the index position of the highest value. If I scan these three positions, let's say position one, position two, and position three, the highest index, 70%, this would be three. So this would return class label three if I apply the argmax. If this is unclear, we will walk through this step by step in the next video. So this was just the introduction of how the softmax regression model looks like. It's basically here the concatenation of individual logistic regression models. And in the next videos, we will talk about softmax and this argmax and how we also compute the loss function.